Good afternoon and welcome to the next session on digitization of financial assets for diversification and broadening of investors. I'm pleased to welcome Mr. Ashish Kumar Chauhan, Managing Director and CEO, Bombay Stock Exchange, for his address. Mr. Chauhan, over to you.
Thank you, Madam. Sri Sunil Sangai, Dr. Saurav Garg, Sri Vijay Chandok, Sri Adil Shetty, Sri Varun Sridhar. Friends, it's an honor once again to be here at what we call the annual CAPM. CAPM used to be a subject, capital asset and pricing model in our MBA. But now I think Sunil Sangai, with his efforts over the last 10 years, has made into an annual event where it has become a course. And today's subject of digitization of financial assets for diversification and broadening of investors is interesting to the extent, of course, he also told me that I need to recall the history of India's financial sector digitization, because we were pretty much the pioneers in the world of digitization in financial markets. The digitization, in a way, really what I call the big bang started immediately after the liberalization. We are celebrating the liberalization's 30 years now, but of course the digital framework started with the automation of stock markets, where order-driven matching systems started happening in India, first time in the world, pretty much any large market. We were the first to do it. And so the matching, the order entry and execution became pretty much really real time. I recall doing, of course, in Mumbai in 1994, November, but in 95, the first terminal of NSE was inaugurated by me in Coimbatore, and people could not believe that in less than 1.5 seconds, they could execute trades which they actually had to settle next day. And that was a revelation to me, because coming from where I worked in, it was very, very sort of easy for me to understand. But the rest of the country also took to it like fish in the water. And those days, we used to trade around 200 crore rupees a day in BSE. That was the maximum volumes. And to settle them used to take minimum 15 days if it was a good time. It used to take probably a month or more. And a lot of defaults used to happen because of that. Today, after 27 years since November 1994, when the first trade started on NSE, we trade close to 50 lakh crore a day. It's like 25,000x. Volumes that has gone up. And one of the reasons why it happens, many times I used to tell even those days, is that when washing machines came, most people thought that the ladies will spend less time in washing clothes, but they start actually washing more clothes. And that's what happened to our markets also, that instead of sort of creating efficiencies, we created so much efficiency that people started trading more, that now we trade literally 50 lakh crores. And it is such a large number that if you tell, everyone gets totally annoyed, or because nobody wants to tell this number, right? The notional value traded has become phenomenally large, and it's increasing every year. And so it's basically where we have come from. We started trading, doing the automation of trading. Then we automated the clearing and settlement processing. We started doing margining, which we were not doing. But real-time margining was also India's gift to the world. That we started doing it real time. We set up depositories, which were not the immobilization kind, but dematerialization kind. And so it took us almost 5-6 years, which other countries have taken 50, 60, 100 years to settle. We did it from 1994 to pretty much 2000, we settled everything. And that, in a way, also was a harbinger or a demonstration to the rest of the world that India has arrived on the IT scene. So if you recall, from 99 onwards, India started doing exceedingly well in IT. To some extent, the financial markets automation had a huge role to play, because Y2K, when it came, we were ready as a country, as a group, to say to the world that we can handle large systems, we can make them, and we can make them actually work in a country like India. And that's where, for me, I give a lot of credit to India's IT success to financial market automation. And of course, before that, the first automation that happened was in railway reservation, but it was for a very small area. The second part I say is that the financial markets digitization also helped India become really one. You could be in Jammu, you could be in Srinagar, you could be in Kanyakumari, you could be in Dibrugarh or Jorhat. You would get the same response time of less than 1.5 seconds across India. And that was also an interesting framework. Otherwise, you had to be close to Dalal Street to get the basic sort of services which are fast. And if you were further away, you would take literally days and months before things would happen. Of course, the banking started also automating. The RTGS helped. NASH help, of course, now UPI is helping in many ways. Algorithm trading has now come in. Most of the orders now, almost 90% of all orders in India now originate from algorithms, not from the humans. And that's a new thing. New instruments have come in. Post 2000, we started giving derivatives. They could not have been traded without a high amount of automation. And that is, again, digitization of sorts. More interesting things, we have been always saying that India was less digital or financially included. In fact, from year 2000 to 2014, I recall having participated in almost 200 to 300 conferences discussing sort of giving suggestions about how to include people financially. Then come 2014, we had this new government. We started seeding Jandan Aadhaar mobile accounts. And in 1 year time, they created close to 30 crore accounts. And that actually brought India into the financial inclusion model. Instead of talking, which we took almost 15 years to do, in 1 year, we could actually execute. And so for me, the execution actually it's the strategies and talk for breakfast. But sometimes we think the talking is the policy, which is more important than execution. Just to give you a perspective, in February 8, 2008, we became 1 crore investors on BSE. BSE had 1 crore investor accounts in February 2008. In July 11, we had 2 crore investor accounts. That doesn't mean they're unique accounts. Every person can have one or two accounts if they want with various brokers or various banks. In January 16, we had 3 crore investor accounts. August 18, we had 4 crore. May 20, we had 5 crore. In January 21, we had 6 crores. June 21, we had 7 crores. So literally, in 4 months, we added 1 crore in January to June. And then on July 29, that is today, we have 7.5 crores. The number of people getting included now in financial markets is unbelievably large. Every day for last so many years, I mean, last actually 1.5 years, we are adding 70,000 people every day. From January 1, 2020, if we say as a start of COVID, we added 60% people. So for 145 years of our history of BSE, we had 4.7 crore investors till January 1, 2020. On July 29, we are 7.5 crore investors, 60% increase in just last 1.5 years during COVID period. And that is what is interesting, because the automation, although Jandan Aadhaar framework has helped people or the brokers create that brokerage accounts very, very fast. And that's a very interesting thing. In some ways, the East is still lagging, but it's picking up. It has 13% of the accounts. But last 1.5 years since COVID started, the East accounts, the customer accounts, have gone up by 68% compared to the average 60%. The North has 28% accounts. Now, in the last 1.5 years, they've gone up by 67%. So again, North is now picking up, in a way, running faster than the rest of the country in opening new accounts. South has 23% accounts, and it grew up by 61%, which is just like the average. The West grew up by, West has 34% current accounts, but grew only by 25%. So the West, which is Gujarat, Maharashtra, used to be the largest number of accounts and largest amount of activity happening. Now is slowly spreading across the country. And that is very interesting. Mobile has now started playing a big role, mobile trading. The geographical reach is very, very large. Now we have people coming from Lakshadweep, Andaman, Nicobar, investing in mutual funds or through the stock directly and so on and so forth. Fintechs are coming in all areas. Traditional institutions are under tremendous pressure to maintain their business model. That includes stock exchanges. You might see more new exchanges coming up, more depositories probably coming up, and many more things that may come up. Traditional institutions also are trying to create newer regulations to maintain their business models or their sort of control over their business. And so that interesting fight which goes on in the backside, which doesn't get discussed, is also going to be interesting to watch. Trading volumes have gone up, as I told you. And at the same time, in some areas, we remain still anachronistic. In the commodities market, we trade from 9 o'clock to 11:55 in the night. But when it comes to equities, we somehow want to stop at 3:30 for whatever reasons. And I've been told the foreigners are more interested in keeping it that way. And of course, the media, actually television media, because of the long time they don't want to work for. But effectively, the rest of the world works longer time, almost 16-hour days. And we have another exchange in India physically, but sort of catering to the foreign clientele. That is in GIFT City. India International Exchange works for 22.5 hours every day. So that technology is available. Whenever it is required, we can actually lengthen the hours even in equities market and equity derivatives markets. T-plus settlement is also easy to do. But I've been told the foreigners don't like it because the way they have complicated situations with the custodians of global and local and so on and so forth, that is going to take some time. And T-plus may not happen in a hurry. But we are pretty much ready as a system in India. New anomalies will come up. New scams will come up, which we can't even fathom. One large scam which happened between 2009 to 2015, two books are written, but still most of us are unaware. We cannot even fathom what happened in those scams. And probably many more interesting scams will come about going forward. And large portion of the regulatory structure would be required to even think about what is happening in those markets. With that, I think overall, the 27 years of automation or digitization in Indian markets, we have come a long way, but we have a long way to go. And it is not necessary that institutions which have been there for 147 years will be successful for the future, or institutions which have been there for 27 years also will be successful in the future, because we are all, digitization for me is like riding a tiger. Ride is very uncomfortable, but when you, if you get down, it eats you up. So everyone is having a very tough ride, very uncomfortable ride, and that also as a country. And for that, India, on a regulatory framework basis, will have to create more institutions, more competing institutions. So if one of them closes down, which happened even recently, even for a small period or large period, other part of the entire ecosystem continues to work. So that is, for me, the lessons we need to learn. But eventually, what as an ecosystem we are doing is we are manufacturing trust. And to maintain and to enhance that trust is what has created this $3 trillion of wealth, which is more important than just incessant trading. Of course, we must trade and as much as the technology allows. But the focus should be on raising funds and creating wealth, creating jobs for the nation. Because next 20 years, India's job is to create jobs. And next 20 years, India has a great opportunity to create wealth. Of course, the trading will remain important, but the focus should be ensuring that the trust continues to continues to be enhanced going forward. With that, I will end my session. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashish. And I totally agree with you that capital market took the lead for digitization. I do remember as a young banker getting involved in BSC computerization project called FIRE project. So thank you for recollecting all of those. Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Sunil Sanghai. I'm the chair of Capital Markets Committee of FICCI. Let me now move to the keynote address session. This is a very, very special session with Dr. Saurav Garg on digitization of the financial assets. Ladies and gentlemen, as you know, we have 1.3 billion people, 1.26 billion Aadhaar cards. 1.2 billion mobile phones. And to weave all of this incredible combination to digitizing the entire country, we couldn't have got a better person to lead this effort than Dr. Saurabh Garg. When I was preparing for his introduction, it was really easy. I really felt that our country's digital program is in absolutely safe hands. Why do I say this? Because it's rare to find a combination, and please hear me. It's IIT Delhi topper, IIM Ahmedabad high ranker, John Hopkins University PhD, and IAS. I have not come across another match. And if you come across, please do pass it on to me. Dr. Garg started his professional career with TAS, the Tata Group, and I'm sure Tata Group would be missing his help in their digital program. So it's a gain to the government of India. Dr. Garg has been always ahead of its time. And there are many, many of his efforts where I had some role to play, so I'm aware of those. He started working on digitization of agriculture when nobody actually even thought of it. He worked on direct transfer of benefit transfer to the farmers even before TBT was conceived. In fact, when we were planning this conference, a lot of his efforts are now reflected in our capital market conference. For example, yesterday we talked about infrastructure where NIIF was present. NIIF was conceived by him. We have first a public partnership, a large infrastructure fund. Gold, we had a session on gold. Actually, when he was a Ministry of Finance, he worked on this initiative of gold, which is now getting fructified. Ladies and gentlemen, now that we have crossed over 176 billion dispersals via digital payment, and where Aadhaar had to play an important role, let's hear from the main man himself on his vision for Aadhaar version 2. Dr. Garg, may I invite you to deliver your keynote address? The format of this program is after your address, Dr. Garg. I'll hand over to Deepak. Deepak is head of Economic Times Digital Program. Deepak will host the panel discussion. Over to you, Dr. Garg.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Sangai, for your very kind words. A pleasure to be on this panel with Mr. Chauhan, Mr. Chandok, Mr. Shetty, Mr. Sridhar, and of course, Mr. Deepak Ajwani. I think it's a very apt to have a discussion on digitization of financial assets at the time of the COVID-19 pandemic, which I think illustrated the impact that one aspect of digitization, which is digital payments, which has had in the country. I was just looking at the data that in 2020-21, that's essentially the entire pandemic period, we had 392 crore transactions over the AEPS, where people have withdrawn funds across the country, which is a 66% rise from 2019-20, when we had 236 crore transactions. So one can imagine the impact that digitization has had and the benefit that it has given to people who could do transactions on AEPS, the Aadhaar-enabled payment system run by the NPCI and backed by the Aadhaar system. Aadhaar has started off as an ID. It has helped in empowering people. It has helped in entitlement-based delivery of services. And in effect, it has transformed the way government schemes are being implemented in terms of how beneficiaries have been identified. Mr. Sangai alluded to that. I think PM Kisan, which came up later, has extensively used the system. It has transformed the way delivery of services is made, that we can even think of direct cash transfer, direct benefits transfer, which perhaps could not have been conceived even a decade back. So in terms of transparency, efficiency, and as importantly, time for implementation, it has really telescoped that. The leakages in the government schemes in just the five flagship schemes that, which includes PDS and LPG subsidy distribution and PM Kisan, etc., is around 1.8 lakh crores over the past 4 to 5 years alone. So that's the kind of savings that DBT mechanism based on Aadhaar has had. And Aadhaar, where it really helps the vulnerable and the sections at the bottom of the pyramid, is the fact that it's an ID which cannot be stolen, it cannot be lost, it cannot be tampered, and it cannot be destroyed, because the person carries that ID with themselves in terms of the biometrics or the demographics which everyone just needs to be able to say. Over time, Aadhaar has become nationally acceptable, and it's verifiable anytime, anywhere. And I think that's where the difference comes from all other IDs, that one can verify it 24/7. The Jandan Aadhaar Mobile, the Jam Trinity, has now around more than 300 schemes which use it. And there were 773 crore transactions during last year on the different schemes that were there. So where do we go from here? And I think that's where the ability of Aadhaar to provide the all-inclusive and verifiable KYC, which is essential for the financial sector, is really where the benefits would come going forward. In the banking sector, out of the 125 crore Aadhaars, 73 crores are already linked to a bank account. So unique Aadhaars, 124 crore, 73 are linked. Out of the 140 crore bank accounts, 120 crore bank accounts are already linked with Aadhaar. And that explains the growth of the Aadhaar payment bridge and the Aadhaar enabled payment systems. Similarly, we have eSign, which helps to verify documents, where in a way it takes care of the otherwise you had to carry the pen drives and things like that, which is there. Similarly, you have the linkage with PAN, which has led to deduplication, etc. The investor base, Mr. Chauhan mentioned, is nearly reaching 8 crores. And that's where I suppose a lot of the growth will come forward, by being able to onboard new investors in a manner which can utilize the KYC mechanism that Aadhaar provides, which is again and verifiable across the country. Similarly, a lot of SEBI intermediaries are already on board, and a lot more we expect in the coming few months as we move ahead. Similarly, in the insurance products and in the pension products, there is no reason why there cannot be, for example, a PAM, just like the JAM, which has Jandhan accounts, Aadhaar, and mobile. You have a pension products, Aadhaar, and mobile kind of a combination. And given the near universal penetration of Aadhaar, and even of mobiles to a great extent, the combination of two is where I think the investment side, the pension side, and the insurance side can work, and we would be very happy to work with them on how this can be expanded. Our capacity is already, we are doing 4 crore authentications per day. Of various kinds of authentications, whether it's e-sign or on the banking side or on the KYC, etc. But there are two aspects which I would just like to highlight, since I'm talking to a lot of fintech professionals and those working in the capital markets. The Aadhaar Act has two provisions which are apart from the mandatory provision which the government is using in terms of transferring benefits, services, and other such programs to the people. But for the private sector, there is Section 4.3, which allows for voluntary use of Aadhaar. And that is where a number of the programs are being done, where a resident can voluntarily share his Aadhaar for utilization in different methods or programs. And the second is the good governance rules 2020, which were promulgated last year, which allows for programs which are focused on social welfare, which are focused on innovation and dissemination of knowledge, and which use digital platforms for good governance, where they can be also the use of the good governance guidelines can be used. So you have one set of areas which are related to, if I can say, good governance, social welfare, and knowledge and innovation. And the second, which is on the voluntary use of Aadhaar, where the resident can voluntarily use it. And these are two areas where a lot more work, a lot more innovation, I would say, would be, we would be very happy to facilitate the different partners to work on this. On our part, we are moving to a private cloud infrastructure so that the capacity is enhanced. We have the state-of-the-art cybersecurity, and which ensures that we have multiple layers of security for the data that we have in to maintain the privacy. So with this digital infrastructure, with this digital background in place, I'm sure moving forward, the way the banking sector has seen the growth of digitalization, I think a lot more we can expect in the other three financial areas of investment, insurance, and pension going forward. So once again, thank you to Fiki. Thank you for inviting me, and look forward to remaining engaged with this sector as we move ahead. Thank you so much.
If I come in, Dr. Garg, thank you very much. This was brilliant. Before I hand over to Deepak, just one addition to the program. I'm tempted to use your time, Dr. Garg. If you're open to a few questions, should be okay. So
sure.
For our friends, viewers, please feel free to log in your questions into the chat box. We'll be happy to accommodate some of them. Dr. Garg has agreed. I'll start with one question which I have first. Dr. Garg, as you rightly mentioned, this is a massive, massive infrastructure and safest infrastructure, right? Because you carry yourself, so there is, you know, it cannot be tampered with. And it's a pipe which has been created literally for every single person in the country. A number of products, as you mentioned, JAM, PAM, can be put through this pipe. What's the plan you have? Do you want to use Aadhaar for other things? And I know there are constraints within the Aadhaar regulations, etc. But within that, there is a possibility to really put through a number of more products through this. Any thoughts on that?
I think the Aadhaar Act and the Supreme Court judgment provides the broad framework under which we operate. And cybersecurity, information security, and privacy would always remain paramount. On that, I think there is no doubt. But even given that, there is a lot of scope for a different kind of applications to get developed. The way we have, I've just mentioned three or four of them, whether it's eSign or AEPS or APB. And there's a scope for a lot more such innovative applications can getting developed. We have had some interactions with some of the players, and going forward, we would be very happy to engage with them and see, while maintaining the basic privacy doctrine and the information security, how it can be leveraged to help, if I can put it that way, the ease of living for people at the bottom of the pyramid. And I think that's an area where a lot of the efforts are being made on the investment side also, as Mr. Chauhan mentioned, and that's where a lot of the efforts are being made on the insurance and pension side also.
There's one interesting question has come up, and then anyone from the panel has anything. The person is asking this, that can Aadhaar, because I know KYC, there was a discussion around a common KYC for the entire financial services sector, not just in the capital market. And now video KYC is also possible. Can Aadhaar become a base, as a base level of KYC, and then you can probably migrate to the different levels of KYC? and do become a kind of add-on KYC agency?
We already have a system of what we call eKYC, where anyone can verify the identity and the demographics that there are. And in fact, CERSAI is there, other agencies are there, which are using the digital infrastructure that we provide of the KYC and developing products on that. So we would be very happy to expand and further develop on how the eKYC, which Aadhaar offers, how it can be merged or developed with others. So definitely, it's a possibility.
Okay.
So Sunil, I have one short question.
Please. Go ahead, Vijay.
Sir, you know, while you just mentioned about the e-sign verification, some of the laws today don't really recognize digital sort of as the mode of operation. For example, a power of attorney today requires you know, a physical access. Is there any efforts to change the law so that, you know, the true benefits of digitization can permeate across? Is there any thinking in that direction?
I may not be able to specifically answer on this question, but I think the overall framework of the government has been to improve, and the digital mission, the Digital India, which is operating, the focus of that has been to ensure how whatever service which is presently being offered on an offline method or on a paper method, how it can be moved to a digital framework. So if there is any such suggestions, I'm sure they would be looked at very, very positively, and whatever changes that are required would definitely be done, while keeping, of course, the broad overall framework in mind. The objective being, as I mentioned, whether it's ease of doing business, the ease of living, how to ensure that, and how ease of even documentation, etc., that you refer to, how that can be done.
Okay. If there are no more thoughts and questions, I think we hand over to Deepak. Deepak, over to you to host the panel discussion.
Thanks, Sunil, and thanks a lot for your keynote address, Dr. Garg. It was pretty interesting to understand the whole gamut and the scope of digitization, which starts from the eKYC and various other features that Aadhaar has. In fact, listening to also Ashish Chauhan, it sort of automatically for me set the agenda and, you know, this panel discussion, because for digitization, for anything in the financial asset space, investment space, it will start with authentication, which is where you come in, Dr. Garg. While on the capital markets and on the stock exchange, like Mr. Chauhan has referred, digitization came in long way back. Way back, you know, technology was introduced, and investor base was sort of broadened. Various cities got connected through the broadband pipes and internet. But where we still lack is getting more and more investors to come and join the money-making party, if I may use that word, right? Go beyond the B30, the top 30 cities of India. So I'll sort of kickstart with just, you know, for those who have just come in, the topic of this panel discussion is digitization of financial assets for diversification and broadening of investors. With me, we have in the panel Mr. Garg from Aadhaar, Mr. Chauhan from Bombay Stock Exchange, and Vijay Chandok from ICICI Securities, Adil Shetty, CEO of BankBazaar.com, and Varun Sridhar, CEO of Paytm Money. Thank you very much, everyone. The journey of digitization for capital markets, from the consumer point of view, if I will, you know, we start there, it started from way back, you know, going paperless and reducing DMAT accounts, paper by paper, inch by inch, you know, the whole process was getting digitized. At least the physical shares were being done away with, and you had your e-shares or, you know, DMAT account, which told you what you hold and how much you hold. And then sort of came in for the consumer perspective again, the old KYC norms. But the last 2 years have done a great deal of good on the digitization journey. Some would say we have been forced. I also hear that CTO job is the most sought after job in all organizations now, because digitization is upon us, and there's no running away from it. Right from my next door Kirana store, which will now prefer to WhatsApp me the entire, you know, menu and then ask order on the WhatsApp, to, of course, today investment going entirely app based. So all mutual funds are being bought also on the app, and we'll hear more from Varun on that also. So, and then on the other hand, which Mr. Chauhan referred to, automation of systems and processes has helped not just for volume, and the volume is huge from the figures that he just talked about. We are also able to handle it very well and, you know, stable. Our technology prowess, the IT systems and the companies that we have in-house in our own country have held it. But if I were to sort of, you know, put in perspective the four sort of big reasons why digitization of financial assets is helpful or important is, of course, first and foremost, to broad-base the investor set. Second, to bring in an ease of investment. We talk of ease of business, here we need ease of investment. Then also give an opportunity to raise funds via the public participation for all kinds of industries. You know, traditionally we've had big, large industries entering the, you know, public markets and, you know, doing an IPO, but this automatically should invite all forms of industries to come and raise money, small or big, you know, it should help them. The other big reason is that, you know, capital markets should give a chance to everyone to make money. And when I say everyone, with the recent Zomato IPO experience, which Mr. You know, Bik Chandani yesterday in one of the FICCI panel talked about, under 30 people were most interested for the first time to invest in an IPO, which was a Zomato IPO, because they ate through Zomato and they wanted to invest in it. So digitization will bring in all of that. Now, taking that journey and, you know, understanding this landscape, if I can come to my first question, and if I can start with you, Dr. Garg. So UIDAI has brought in Aadhaar, and you only talked about eKYC. Is there a possibility of an investment passport, so to say, which can be institutionalized by your organization and then, you know, acceptable to the entire investment fraternity, which has all layers, which Sunil also referred to, that you should be able to, once you cleared your e-investment passport, if I can use the word, and then it sort of allows everyone and everyone to have one single authentication sign on, and then you're able to invest in various kinds of markets. Is that something that's even possible?
As UIDAI, we would be able to provide the infrastructure which can enable such a passport. So, for example, the way you log in, if you log in through your Aadhaar, using your Aadhaar ID, you can authenticate that ID, and once you have logged in into a secure, whether it's an app or an area, and then you can move ahead from there, knowing that the person who has logged in into that app has logged in through a secure ID which has been verified. I think it would not be our mandate to develop such a, if I can call it, the passport, but where we can facilitate other agencies who can develop such a passport using the Aadhaar infrastructure, and on a consent, as I mentioned, a voluntary based, if an investor voluntarily wants to use this as an ID to get into an area or a sector where then they can get into a trusted area where the investments can be made, definitely it should be possible.
You know, taking this to Vijay, if I can come to you, Mr. Garg says this is upon the industry. So as a fraternity, can you and various other companies which are in this space, be it you know, Bank Bazaar, Paytm, and bringing in the stock exchanges, is there a possibility that the industry comes together and launches a common kind of app which takes help from the authentication front from UIDAI and sort of take it further?
Yeah, in fact, that's a great point, Deepak, and it's so incidental that just 3 days back, I think, SEBI has come out with a circular. This is in connection with mutual funds, precisely on the point that you said, you know, the RTAs coming together along with the AMCs to create an industry-wide platform, which is interoperable, so that you have a ability of all mutual funds under one platform, which is an initiative of the industry, to offer all the options, all the schemes, various other issues that investors face in terms of change of address, change of whatever they need to do, their certain parts of their credentials, all that is possible. So that is something which SEBI has sort of put together, mandated, and there it's not just mandated, but it's also coming with a deadline. So I think 31st of this year end, it has got to be up and about. And it's, yesterday I was listening to some of the discussions around that. AMFI is driving that quite actively, and possibly we'll see some phases of it coming even sooner than that. So it's very much happening.
True, I read that circular and I was thinking to myself that, hey, this is one great move and a great point. But taking it further, Varun, if I can come to you. So you have all mutual funds being mandated now to come on a single platform, interoperable. So that brings ease of use and ease of invest for the investor. How does one take it further on platforms such as yours or digital wallets or digital platforms? And what is the ease of use that will bring?
I think that's a very good question. Thank you to people talk to you. I think the question that we must ask ourselves is, we start thinking about, right? Can we get to, is there an audio issue?
There is an echo. Not sure if it's the system led.
Is it better now?
Can you, yeah, let's start again.
Yeah, so I think the question for all of us is to see how we can get to 300 million accounts, right, of 300 million investors in India, right? And today we are not there. We have 300 million people doing digital payments. The question to ask is, how do we get there for the capital markets thing? And I think there are three layers of it, right? Obviously, what's happening, and I think Aadhaar Rails or what SEBI is doing is fantastic, right? We welcome it because it just makes life easy. But to get to a Jan Nivesh program, I think we fundamentally need to start thinking, how do we make investing as simple as a wallet for somebody who has 500 rupees? Today in India, whether you're a 500 rupee customer or a 5 crore customer or a 50 crore customer, we treat everyone with the same lens, right? And I think there are three pillars of that. So if you think about it, saying we want to have 300 million people, for example, start with a mutual fund. And I don't know whether it's a mutual fund, but we must talk about that later. But you want to do that. How do you do it, right? There are three legs to it. The first leg is education. We produce the best architects, journalists, data scientists, but we don't teach education on very basics, like how to save and invest. I think we need to fix it as a industry, right? So that's one thing you fix. The second thing you fix is regulation to simplify the first time investor who wants to do 1,000 rupees. Like, he can't go through the same lens as everybody else, right? If he has an Aadhaar enabled number, 1 second verification is up and running, let him or her start his first 500 rupee investment. Even a 50 rupee investment, it doesn't matter. I think the fact is they want to try. And I think the third rail is the right product. Ashish spoke about it very well. Everybody wants to trade, right? And I think that's, most people don't understand what they're getting into. And I know we're all very euphoric about the current market. But every time I go and talk to young people, I tell them, hey, look, the market's in a bull run. We are doing well. But I want to visualize the same market. Markets go up and down, right? And I think it's our role as a fraternity to protect our investors' very hard-earned money. These are people with a lot of young dreams and a lot of, a lot of hard work capital. How do you protect that? I think you give the right products out. And I don't think the system today can change to bring forward, for example, ETFs, to bring forward, for example, index-based funds, right? We are pushing people to give them very simple alternatives to savings account. Like, we've always spoken about it at Paytm, saying, how can we make sure that somebody is able to buy a burger or take an Uber ride with a mutual fund? Right, the day that happens, I scan my QR code and it's a mutual fund on the back, you will have 300 million Indians doing it. So I think the question is, how do we get Jan Nivesh going? And I think what Dr. Garg said is fantastic, and I'm going to reach out to him later and maybe chat up with him and go visit him in Delhi and ask him this question, saying, how do we get to the 300 million accounts? Right, because that's been our dream at Paytm, and we think only that can really fundamentally alter the Indian market.
Thanks, Varun. So, in a nutshell, if I can summarize this, while mutual funds sahi hai, digitization ke liye, ya digitization ki wajah se, investment ka tarika yahi hai. There's one only digitization which can facilitate, if I can understand from what you've said. So, Adil, if I can get you in, there is investment opportunity, there is digitization that will kick in. There is money lying in the banks for a lot of investors who are earning barely anything with their FDs, right? But they're still scared. There is an inhibition, or there is a risk level definitely associated with all forms of investment, especially in the equity side. Does technology have a role to play here in terms of minimizing risk? If there is algo trading, there can be algos enough to tell you and automatically stop your transactions if required, if you've taken way too much risk. Is there a role of digitization and technology in, you know, the risk mitigation also?
So great question, Deepak. I think technology has a key role to play with access. So let's start with that. I think technology essentially ensures that anyone who needs to access that digitized asset can access it. And I think there is a role it has to play in helping manage risk, but I think education has a lot to do with it also. What we've clearly seen, right, and this has happened in the 18 months of the pandemic, consumers want to do everything digitally. They don't want someone to come to their house to pick up their KYC. They don't want to hand over any documents. They just want to get things done digitally. Now, I think like you rightly pointed out, Dr. Garg spoke about this earlier, even if the financial asset itself is digitized, it's very important that access to that asset, which is the KYC, that is digital also. And I think I really must commend what the regulators and the government have done over the last 18 months. I think video KYC has become the norm. I think offline KYC, XML, is being used a lot in the non-banking industries. And today at BankBazaar, we see 80% of all financial transactions are happening via the video or the offline XML route. And a tremendous amount of work has been done there. Now that access is available, I think it's really up to us to ensure that the right product goes to the right consumer. Because just because a product is accessible, it might or might not be the right product for that particular consumer. But I think technology has a role to play there, combined with educating consumers, right? Saying that this is your current stage in life, and these are the kinds of products that you will benefit from.
Can I add something, Deepak, if you don't mind? Yeah, I think, you know, imagine a world where you spoke about an investment process. And the investment passport makes 100% you're able to add right? Like you can do some sort of this model, which is very easy to build, a very simple robot, which is bias free, and to offer it. And how do you onboard clients to it using data science? Because clients don't need to come and say, this is my risk profile. There is enough digital footprint out there which can tell you, respecting data privacy, this is the client's risk capital. And I think if you think of the direction of robo advisors and digital advisors, automated, it removes bias, removes misguidance, removes misselling, and makes it very transparent. So, you know, back to Adil's point, I think it's a great point that technology really can, you know, take us where we want to go, which is to find the right clients, the right product.
Sure. Thanks.
In fact, I just want to add a couple of points here. I think clearly we see that at least in capital markets and the world of investment, technology indeed can play a big role in managing risks better. Let me try and elaborate with some use cases or example. I think we have democratized as an industry access. I think whether it is payments, whether it is access to capital markets, mutual funds, I think that access has been democratized quite strongly. But what is still WIP, I think, is access to knowledge and research. And that can be a big game changer in enabling customers to understand what is he getting into and whether he has access to informed decision making. I think technology has, and today what we also find, Deepak, is that many young Indians are able to, they are very well read, they are, you know, very able to understand themes, trends, etc. So they, for example, are all aware of the Atmanirbhar, program of the Prime Minister. Many people believe in the China Plus One strategy. It's going to happen. The post-pandemic growth is going to come sooner or later. All of that people believe. But if we were to translate these beliefs, these policies into how can I use this information to participate in the capital markets, and you gave the example of it should enable people to make money. I think that's where research using technology can be sort of packaged and presented to him in thematic basket formats. So if you believe, let's say, in a China plus one strategy, here are a bunch of five guys who you can invest in, five stocks or five sort of collection of instruments that you can invest in. That can be sort of very easily and conveniently brought to the customer. One click, just like you given access to become to access markets, you can give them access to research, click, and you can invest. And then whatever needs to be done, because the portfolio also has to be sort of alerted against changes that keep taking place dynamically in the market, alerts can be sort of again given. So I think those are examples. We have a brand called One Click Investment, we call it that, where we find young Indian investors love that way of investing. So certainly managing risk is possible.
Sure. Thanks. Mr. Chauhan, if I can come to you. Till now we've been talking of ease of investment from the consumer or layperson's side. How about using digitization and technology, which you've been doing at the exchanges, to broad base those who want to even offer, and do a public float, right? We've had enough companies over the last few years who've come and debuted on, your exchange and collected money from people with the trust and faith that, hey, we're going to make more money with your money, right? How have you used technology? And if I can, ask you, can you give us a peep into the window as to what's happening with digitization and technology in the exchange side to broad-base even those who receive investor money? And how are they using technology to, mitigate not just risk, but understand themselves also the investor participation and broad-base that further?
That's an interesting question. There are two aspects to it. One is to raise the funds. Just to give you a perspective, on this month, one single day, India did 1.1 crore, okay, of trading volume. That is pretty much $1.33 trillion. India's GDP gets traded once in 2 days. Okay, so that is the kind of volumes, and I was telling you 50,000 crore, but I've been just sort of sent a message by one of the listeners saying, boss, you are wrong. In the meantime, last 1 month, we have gone up more than double. And so that is the kind of speed. And that takes you to the over-trading part. But you also mentioned about making money. See, coming to markets, everyone may not make money. And so I just want you to also make it clear that people may lose money. And we should be basically informing everyone that this is not about fixed deposits where you're sort of you keep on getting the returns every day. You may lose money for a particular point, although long term you hope to get money. So that is one part. The second part is last year, 2020-21, BSE alone raised $253 billion worth capital for Indian corporates, Indian governments, municipalities, IDBs, REITs put together. $253 billion is a very large number. Okay, I mean, none of us actually believe those kind of numbers. In fact, today morning also in one of the listings, somebody told me that, yeah, we must be raising to 75,000 crore. I said, no, 18.53 lakh crores were raised last year. And that's a very large number compared to our expectation. Of course, compared to our trading volume, it's nothing. But in terms of the raising of funds for capital markets, it's now using commercial papers and all. We raised like a very, very large sum and completely automated. In commercial papers, they are filing the document in the morning. By afternoon, they've collected the money and gone. The issuers on a private basis, they're in their place. Everything is done literally in a T plus zero basis now, not even T plus one, T plus two basis. On the fundraising for the commercial papers, of course, the IPOs now get listed in 3-4 days. Earlier, it used to take like 60 days, 20 years back. Today, on the issue day close, within 3-4 days, you will get the sort of listing done. And that's, again, because automation has helped. In terms of maintaining the confidence, because once you invest, you need the continuous information about the companies, about their doing stuff, material events, their quarterly results, their board details and stuff like that. And that is where we again provide 24/7 services to each company to log in using their registered mobiles. We send them OTP so that we know that it's the same person, because earlier people used to send faxes on behalf of others or fake faxes giving wrong information. So now we send this OTP, he or she puts in the detail. Instantly, within few milliseconds, the data goes to BSE's website and BSE Street and other things. And that basically ensures that 24/7, any report which the company wants to give, whether it is a material event or a periodic activity like quarterly results or annual reports or something, that goes to the investors on real time. And of course, on BSE's website, you get to see all the prices free, all the company-related information free, including a lot of analyst reports and all sorts of funky stuff. Literally, we get 100 million page views. We are one of the most visited websites in the world. Nowhere, I mean, you don't go to New York Stock Exchange when you are in US, but you go to BSE India website, bseindia.com, when you are in US, because here you get it free. In US, you have to pay $1,700 per month to either Reuters or Bloomberg or somebody. In India, better information comes to investors on their mobile or on their website free of cost on real time, as if it's, and it's coming from the horse's mouth, that is from the companies, from the markets which are placing orders and so on and so forth.
Right. Thanks a lot for that perspective. Varun, you know, Paytm is about to IPO, but forget Paytm aside, I'm sure you're not allowed to talk about your own IPO maybe, but do you envisage an entire IPO being conducted on an app, right from your DRHP state filing to all the other regulatory issues to even the investor side, where people, just like today, one can buy mutual funds on your own app. People should be able to participate in an IPO through that with the help of UIDAI, Aadhaar, and with the help of, you know, exchanges also facilitating everything, post-listing, buying, selling, everything. Is that something on the horizon?
I can only imagine and believe that this is going to happen. And I think India is there. I think technology is ready, platforms are ready. Regulator seems to be thinking in the right direction. And I think eventually, as transparency, I think investor confidence is so important, right? Because when things move fast, you want to make sure that the checkpoints are there, right? What I love about the Indian capital markets is between SEBI, depositories, people looking at all this work. That process is good. So technology is there. I think we are ready to do that from a customer perspective. There are enough startups out there to find this a better route to funding. I'd rather go to BSE and invest. And I know they did talk about it, but they have a great startup funding for a small business funding house. And I think that is the future. And I think, you know, you'll see it in the next couple of years. Somebody will make it reality very soon.
So I'm going to jump in, Deepak. And the point that you said actually is already happening. And then let me explain with you with some examples. Last year, when we had the first lockdown, you know, quarter one of the fiscal year, there was complete fear in the markets. Nobody knew what's going to happen, uncertainty, etc. But commencement of quarter two, people started venturing out, trying to understand whether, okay, is it time to now start raising money? There was a lot of uncertainty even then. That was the time when we went out and we took one of our companies, the first company, our post-pandemic lockdown, round one, into the markets through an IPO. Now that IPO, which was carried out, this company called Rosario Biotech, was the first all digital IPO, right? Typically the process that you need to go through is first the conversations that you have to do to, you know, sell the story to the investors. It all happened like this. It was WebEx and Zoom and so on and so forth. So no need to travel. Otherwise, if you had to travel, you jump into a flight, go to investors in Asia, Europe and US. But, you know, today it was all possible to, this time it was all possible to do digitally. So digital communication, marketing of the issuances, access to investors, uploading of the DRHP and the point that you made, all to SEBI, all digitized. Responses, doing and flowing, all digital. And then finally, when the IPO happened, it happened in a digital format. So you don't need to step out into a branch or of any entity or any specific place. You download an app, all of us offer these services, 3, 4, 5 clicks and you're done. So it's actually happening end to end. All money that got raised after this, let's say July of last year, and that amount I think was so elaborately explained by Ashish, all of that is all digital. There is no more physical meetings at all. Deals are happening already. So we are seeing it pretty much in action.
You know, on that point, Adil, technology is a boon, but it can be a pain. It is a beast to understand with so many security issues that have come about. I mean, forget Pegasus and the entire episode rocking the parliament right now, but there are enough threats and challenges with the spyware, ransomware, everything that is going around the globe in the last few months, especially in the US when factories and industries have had to halt. Where does, you know, what are the risks that are involved in 100% digitization, if there are any? And how does one go about mitigating it? Because look, there is no going back now. There's only way forward. But is the industry, be it the fintech industry, or the exchanges, and you know, companies like ICICI Securities, what are the conversations happening on the risk of technology, or even the fraudulent use of technology, if I may use that? We've had, you know, examples of fastest fingers first in exchanges, and you know, people punching fast enough to trade fast enough. But so those were misuse of technology, so to say. And you know, if it happens too much, then regulation will come and throttle everything, which is a risk you run. That's a bigger risk you run. You know, China's right now doing that to the fintech industry, if you've, you know, seen. So the balance lies in being responsible ourselves and bringing about those changes so that we don't go to the extreme level of getting regulated heavily. So yeah, your thoughts on this?
Yeah, sure. So let me just take some very contemporary examples, right, to see what is happening and three things which I feel are critical. So one is it really helps to have secure platforms. So you think of, you know, Aadhaar as a platform or BSE as a platform. The very fact that you have a secure platform which ensures that information is being managed correctly, right, makes a big difference. Now, earlier we were talking about robo-advisors, right? Now, people might have access to proprietary data or might have access to their data, but there is a framework called Account Aggregator. Now, this is a authorized RBI-driven framework for all regulated entities. It doesn't matter whether you're in capital markets or in banking, to share securely information about the consumer's assets basis their consent. Now, I think we need to invest in platform because that takes a tremendous amount of risk away, right? Because there's only so much an individual operator can do when the platform is secure. That's step number one. Second, right, we've been talking about cloud. So a very, very interesting question was answered on cloud because, you know, as far as banking is concerned, we do video KYC. The RBI has confirmed that cloud is the way to go, but obviously with a number of information security checks. So I think the age of cloud is here. We need to deeply invest in information security, but you know, we've moved to a level wherein clearly the regulator themselves are coming out and clarifying to all market participants that your video KYC technology can be on the cloud. And you know, as long as you have the information security, the data purges in place, this is allowed and sanctioned by the regulator. The last, right, is I think that at every agent who works with the platform, management needs to have the investment in InfoSec. Now, whether it starts from PCI, DSS, or ISMS, I think every company needs to invest in that dedicated information security practice because the challenges out there, Deepak, like you said, are tremendous. International state actors, we are under attack. I think that investment and that commitment, right, whether it is in the certification, whether it is in a dedicated practice in order to maintain it, and also coordinating with the government when something happens, I think information security is a key priority today.
Thanks.
Is that the way? Yeah, the way to look at the information security and the outcome, what should be the strategy for India as a country? What will happen is that each components, like what you mentioned about US, some portions go down. But if we create systems and processes which are basically monopolistic, then If you take away that monopoly, entire country stops for that activity. But if you create competing products, competing sort of service providers in that same industry, for example, NPCI is one case in point. Now RBI has figured out that NPCI has become so big that if it fails, it's a failure for the country. That's why they want basically competition to come in. For me, we need to design the service providers even at that level, other providers or sort of payment sort of infrastructure or exchanges in a way which are competitive. So we have like two exchanges. When one exchange failed, the other exchange continued. And that way, the system doesn't fail as a whole. Components will keep on failing because of whatever reasons. But if you create monopolies by design, by plan, or by accident, you are putting the entire country at risk by doing this. That's why for me, the lesson which I learned is that as a strategy, the country cannot have one single provider of infrastructure by design or by plan or even by accident. Because that is actually putting the entire country in risk. And what happens, because it is easy to deal with that guy for a variety of reasons, actually monopolies perpetuate itself, and then that creates a huge risk for the entire country. So somewhere in the line, the design of the system, even regulations, should be to promote competition, not one, not two, but probably 5-10, so that the components will keep on failing. I mean, if nobody is today sure that a particular exchange will not fail or a particular service provider will not fail. They may fail, but overall, when Amazon fails, Google continues, right? And that's what we need to plan as a policy making, rather than just trying to create monopolies. And if one of them fails, overall, because of dominoes, everyone else fails. Because if you can't make payments, you can't run stock markets, right? And that's where basically if one of them fails, you will have a lot of other dependencies. But if the components are competing, if one brokerage fails, other places, people are able to trade, they are basically anyway safe, at least for their portion. Although that brokerage may not be able to trade, the rest of the country continues its job. And that's how the policy making should happen.
So, you know, from a wider participation of investor set that we've been talking about, you're talking about, Ashish, wider participation of platforms so that, you know, even one fails, the entire system doesn't need to crash. Have enough places, have enough companies, have enough investors, and there's a wider participation, right? So that one part doesn't bring the whole system down. There are enough parts and enough players, so to say, where the investment journey continues, so to say. Great. Thanks a lot. I'm mindful of the time. We've exceeded partly some bit of our allotted time. So thank you so much, everyone, for your participation and your wise counsel on this topic. I have thoroughly enjoyed personally speaking to all of you and understanding the perspective from a wide gamut of people that we've had. I'm sure our viewers also. So on that note, thank you so much. We'll end this session right now. Thank you.